those Gucci slides, what?
Yeah, they look like a big, actually, are they actually?
No, they're bootleg from China.
They're not, I love them, they're not. Yes.
To enjoy the music in the supermarket. Yeah, that's worrying.
Thank you. suppose anybody in this crowd owns a lovely silver Renault Brandy luxurious car that's outside. The engine is running, it's on its own, it's a push start, you can't turn it off. Nobody here? Okay. Say again? Yeah.
You need to get
a silver Renault.
The license number.
What's the license number? Renault, 5 digits. We're going to try and find who it is. We're also missing just one of our players, unfortunately, so we'll be delayed 5 minutes, okay? Thank you.
Thank you.
like an extra minute later to just start the regular slot when everyone expects it. So, welcome to the Randall Quilter Legends of Squash. A whole bunch of people up in that section who I cannot get to move into this section, but I'm sure they will once they see it, they hear the balls bouncing around. To get us started this evening, I would like, first of all, to welcome you guys. Without people supporting squash events, not just here, but I guess all the events within our lovely sport around the world, there wouldn't be anything to come and watch. So thanks for buying tickets, thanks for being here. Without you guys, especially our sponsors, there would be no Randall Quilter Legends of Squash. So thank you to Link, KPMG, Coral Beach, Chubb, Guy Carpenter, Fast Forward Freight, FIL, and Liz Martin Graphics, and of course, our title sponsor, Randall Quilter. If I could ask you just for now, give us a round of applause for our sponsors. I'm looking around our knowledgeable crowd. There's no need for me to explain any rules or scoring or any of that. The only person who doesn't know much about this game possibly is the referee in the hot seat right in the middle there. Spencer Moss is refusing to look at me or acknowledge me speaking, but Spencer's our ref this evening. We wish you the best, Spencer. Elijah's in charge of live streaming technology and all things that I don't know anything about. Good luck, Elijah. And without further ado, I have some players to welcome onto the court. So I think they are ready at this stage. I'm just going to cast my eye down there and see them bouncing around. I lost one of them due to a taxi for about half an hour there. He's only a triple world champion, four-time British Open champion, so tough to replace at short notice. But luckily, he managed to find his way here. So, we have two fantastic players, the first of which I'm really thrilled to welcome to Bermuda. It's his first visit here. He's a legend of legends, if you will. He's somebody that I was watching for many years, and I just spent 5 minutes talking to him about an era of squash, which is brilliant. So if you get the chance to ask him about playing Jansha Khan and Jahangir Khan and being at a completely different level of squash and a different time of squash for me, it's really cool. So we've got him here. He's 47 years old. He's a former world number two. He's a former British champion. He's a former world team champion. He is from England. Please welcome Peter Marshall. Peter's opponent this evening. He is from Australia. He is 42 years old. He's no stranger to Bermuda. He is a former world number one. He's a winner of 20 PSA World Tour titles. He's a two-time World Open winner, a four-time British Open winner, a two-time World Team champion. Please welcome David Palmer.
Thank you. trophy. Brand new Brooklyn Legends of Squash match number one. Peter Marshall to serve, Dave Palmer to receive. Best of three games, love all. Yes, left. Thank you. Take it all. The pickup is good.
Thank you.
Our announcer had to get some food. one game to love. Love all. Yep, 6-3. 5'8".
Amazing legends of squash. Please welcome back Peter Marshall and David. I think you guys enjoyed that. I certainly did. Usually I get dragged out to do a few things in between these games, but there's no way I was leaving that one. It was fantastic. Such amazing squash and movement around the court, and it looked effortless, Peter.
Oh, yeah.
No, seriously, it's a treat to watch you play. We were chatting a lot about squash just before you came on, about your opponent as well, and a couple of years age difference between you. Did you feel that during the match this evening?
How many days? 40, 42. 42 in a bit, 42 in a bit, yeah.
I'm 48 next month. So, finally getting close to 50, which is quite scary, really, to be trying to play and move around the squash court. But, no, I really enjoyed it. It was great. It was really good fun. Obviously, you know, playing someone of Dave's caliber is, you know, I don't get to do that very often. Apart from last night, obviously, when I played Clarky. Very, very infrequent I get that, you know, privilege to go on court with someone like Dave. So it was, you know, normally these days I pick and choose my matches quite carefully, mid game. So I normally feel like I'm just about in control and I don't have to move too much. But that obviously wasn't the case tonight. But I didn't think it was tough, but I did really enjoy it.
So talking about. Did you cross paths in your professional careers? Was there one particular match or any moments that stood out for you with this guy particularly?
Obviously Peter was when I was just coming on the tour, Peter was the one really pushing. And again, if you don't know, you should look into his history. It's a really amazing story how he was, just as Janshul was taking off, he was the biggest competitor and pushing Janshul away before, unfortunately, he got ill. And that was sort of when I pushed up, and then he made this incredible comeback, and within like 12 months was back in the top 10. I think we did play twice. Yeah. I think you beat me the first time, I got you at the end. But I look up to this guy a lot. I've watched a lot of his videos over the years. Everyone says it, but again, I feel it today, but his length is one of the best lengths of all time. How straight he hits it, how good he hits it, and obviously his fitness in his day, he was one of the fittest guys. So I really looked into him a lot when I was coming up, and all credit to him to be able to play at the way he still is at 48. So I'm happy to play him, I'm happy to get off. I did not want to go three games there, sorry. But it was all fun, so.
Somebody else. It makes us all feel a little bit better about squash. It's okay. There's always someone who's got an amazing backhand drop out the back with two hands that looks impossible. So, talking of comebacks and rankings, and then you know getting ill and coming back again. In your story, you were saying about a comeback a couple of years out and a world championship.
That's right, yeah.
From '97, I think, which was
right.
An amazing event.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I was there. I was younger. I was in the crowd at the very top, and I did watch your game. But that run of results in there was phenomenal, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's right. So I had two comebacks actually. I've not many comebacks, but I had two main comebacks. And the first one was after, so I was ill in 22, 23, took about 2 years out, and then came back. And obviously, I had to start right from the bottom again, right from there. So I was not ranked at all, start from whatever 300 in the world. Then after probably 4 or 5 months, I got up to, I can't remember, probably the top 50, and it was the World Open. And I had to qualify because my ranking was so low. And I managed to get through the qualifying, and then I actually played Brett Martin in the first round, who was, I can't remember, he was probably top 8 in the world at the time. Managed to get through him, then I played Dan Jensen, who's another top 10 in the world player. Then in the quarterfinal, I played Jonathan Power, who's still here, but I'll mention this one because I got a win. somehow I got a win. And then lost in the semi-final. I had to come from qualifying to get through the semis. And then, that probably finished me off for about another year. That was kind of like a major effort for me. I probably still wasn't 100% kind of physically right and that. But it's one of those things that, I was kind of like a blessing in this club. There was kind of a positive and a negative. I was probably so naturally, well, not naturally fit, but I'd worked so hard and so mentally strong, I could push myself and probably, I shouldn't be really on court. So I had that ability to push myself, but then that probably also meant that I took longer out than what I hopefully should have done. But that was a kind of a big event for me. But paid the price for it. But looking back at it, it was just about worth it.
Amazing results and unbelievable careers in squash, and still some of the best guys in the world to watch play. So thank you very much for an amazing performance. We're going to have a little intermission as we usually do before we're back for the next game of the evening. So we'll take about 10 minutes. We'll give a huge round of applause to Peter Marshall and David Palmer.
Yeah.
welcome back for game two of Legends of Squash. If not here, I'll bring you a beer immediately as soon as I'm free. Our players are ready if you guys are. First on court, he is from England. You guys hear me?
Yep.
You guys hear me?
Yes.
Hello? Testing?
Yeah, we can hear you. Yeah.
All right, from England, he is 40-something years old. Former world number 14. He is a two-time European champion. He's the current world over 40 champion. Please welcome Nick Taylor. Nick's opponent this evening, originally from Australia, represents Scotland. He is a former world number one with 13 world tour titles. World Open finalist, British Open finalist. Please welcome John White. Thank you.
you.
I was going to give you a stroke, but
we.
Yes, let. 7-6. Thank you.
One love.
Yeah. 8-4. Love. He was there. 8-0. It was up and up, but he was there. 8-0.
And then you start to, you know, he's a mate and you feel sorry for him and you give him a So, I mean, you know, I mean, that's the problem with him playing with him, and you just don't know what to expect all the time. It's impressive. I knew on match ball that 10-9, and I was trying to find another service box to serve from. If I serve from the left, he's going to hit the nick. If I serve from the right, he's going to hit the nick. So, there you go.
I know exactly what you mean. I've been stood here watching. I've been watching with all of the other pledgeants who are in the draw. Every single one of them stood on the side here, watching that last serve going, I know what's going to happen. And then it happens, and all six of them run straight out the door and disappear. I think everyone's been on the end of it, you just know it's coming. I mean, you don't even think, it's just the shot that happens. Someone serves and you got a match ball to go for, you just smash it and nick.
Yeah.
I love interviewing John White, it's fantastic. You can delve right in there and find out all the juicy bits. I am going to ask you for your most enjoyable moment on court in your career. Today.
Most enjoyable, I guess, on the tour was probably the World Open in Antwerp. I played Peter Nicol and we played it a few times and everything came together and I couldn't make any errors and you know, I won in like 32 minutes, 311 so far in the Worlds. Now, but previous to that was, you know, when I was a junior coming up the ranks, as you all know, Brett Martin, he was an idol of mine and he used to come to the club and I'd have a call with him and have a hit and, you know, just to walk on court with him and you know, he was so happy to have a few and you learned so much from him and that's pretty much where, you know, I got a lot of my, obviously my style from and, you know, you didn't know what to expect when he was playing, but, you know, as a junior going on the circuit, you know, playing the circuit and having someone of that caliber, he was, you know, an hour away from you, and then you know we ended up, you know, training partners. So, you know, that's quite a special memory. But plus also, any of the wins on the tour, but you know, 17 years on the tour is always special. And, this will be one of my mantelpieces of beating Nicky T. I was a better player of the day, and you're probably going. Will that be it?
I might do tonight.
Sure.
First time ever.
First time.
I mean, that's the problem, though. I mean, it, like, you know, he had a couple of beers yesterday. He's more dangerous, like Dave Evans. You know, he's 28 beers and he's more dangerous playing like that. I'd rather him be in bed early and like rested up, got more chance of beating him.
Can I go to the bar?
Do you know where it is?
It's
got his name all over it. Ladies and gents, it was an amazing match. Hope you all enjoyed it. Huge round of applause for our two awesome legends. Let's tell you the show. We've got 10 minutes. We've got 10 minutes to get a quick drink, use the bathrooms, get back for our next game. Thank you. 10 minutes.
I'm Well, maybe it was having done.
No.
Sure, so Thank you.
Marky.
Thank you.
takes four.
Ball.
out, one love. One love.
Thank you.
6-5.
Yeah.
One left. Two left. Eight, five. Go. Yeah, 9-5.
Ladies and gentlemen, please round of applause for these amazing athletes. Simon, how do you feel?
I don't look.
Awesome, as always.
I'm pretty tired, a bit disappointed. I fell off it a bit in the third there. Probably needed to win in two, really. Obviously, I had a good chance of doing. Sneak through, it's probably a bit lucky in the first to sneak through. Just didn't take the opportunity in the second, but Emu played really well considering.
Considering your talent and ability of fitness. Absolutely.
Anyway.
David's got a nickname of Emu.
Don't know why.
We don't know why. It also appeared that you stole the shot off him as well. I think for the first half, or at least most of the first set, you hit a post in the two front corners every third shot. It worked over and over and over again, and then it seems to be your shot now. It's stolen and it's now yours, and you got you with it right on match ball as well. It's a fantastic squash though. As usual, you seem to be able to wait and wait and wait and wait till the last second, and then decide where you're going to hit the ball. Do you know much earlier? Or do you wait till the last second before you know where it's going?
Good question, that. If I show off, I say yes, I know exactly where it's going every time. you pick a shot as you're going to the ball, you know what you're going to play. That's the plan anyway. And then I just hold it as long as I can and then try and carry on with the shot that I've already decided that I'm going to play. But you do get caught in two minds sometimes.
He's known for it, right? Like, I mean, you can kind of see it in the way that he plays, that the racket's there, and it waits, and it waits, and it waits, and then you go, but then he hits something, and every time it's different. And I think David Palmer was saying about you last night, which is definitely one of the things that he's known for, but it's apparent, and it makes you work quite hard.
Absolutely. Being on the receiving end of that is a nightmare,
really. Dave's a good example for coaches or players who are trying to develop and work on deception and delay and what we call holding. As he says, it's not rocket science. It's not, a lot of players try and do really tricky shots and, you know, mix it, play it in different ways, but to be honest, the best way is like Dave does, is to get there early with the same preparation. Shivani used to do it as well, and then delay as long as you possibly can. But it's the earliness of the ball, isn't it, that gives you those options.
Just like with the juniors, it's just getting in a good position to be able to hit three shots from that same position. So straight away, your opponent doesn't know what you're doing because you're able to hit those three shots. So you sort of half on the battle then before you start.
It sounds easy, though.
That's what the book says anyway.
Can't do it.
Sorry,
it is, I mean, but it sounds kind of simple and it seems easy, but it's very difficult to do it at pace. Especially when your lungs are hurting and your legs are hurting and you've been to all four corners of the court and then you still manage to do it. You guys still do it, even after all these years. No, both of you do. We're all squash fans, or hopefully we're all squash fans now. We should be. These guys are obviously legends like everybody else, but I've been watching both these guys for many, many years. And I remember watching Simon win British Championships and I was winning on glass courts many, many years ago, and just, I don't know whether you would describe yourself as this, but an incredible fighter. You know, your retrieval abilities is phenomenal, and I don't know, maybe you can mention anything about the way Simon played over the years.
I've been on the wrong end of many a lost list assignment over the years, so I'll take that. Sorry? It doesn't matter. They still hurt. But Simon, he's got a 3 in the world, US Open champion. You don't get that by luck. He picks up a lot of balls. He's mentally very strong, but he does put the ball away as well. So you can't get that high in the world if you're not doing a lot of things right. And it's always been a tough battle every time I've played it. And like me, really, it's always been a good battle when we're on there. So, but it's always been 3-2 or 2-1. Just wish it was best of 3 a few years ago.
A vote for a change in the rules of best of 3 straight up there. For yourself, so you got to 3 in the world. You had amazing results all the way through, but one stands out because winning the British Open is something that's quite special, and especially at that time, it's the biggest tournament in the world by far. So what does it feel like making a British Open final and then preparing for a British Open final, going out there knowing it's the biggest, probably the biggest day of your career, right?
To be honest, that event was just a bit sort of weird. It all unfolded, all the top seeds were getting knocked out in sort of the earlier rounds. And sort of the draw opened up. It's one of those where you need to take advantage of it, really. It might not ever happen again. So all the top seeds were sort of having 5 setters losing, and I was getting playing the next person, then a little bit tired. You need a little bit of luck to get through matches sometimes. But I just tried not to think about it. I know that sounds ridiculous. Obviously, it's the biggest event that I've ever been in. Just tried not to build it up too much, really. With the same routine, what I was doing in the night. Tried to take advantage of a good opportunity that was there. But obviously, the other guys that I was playing, it was the same for them as well. It was their opportunity because of all the main seeds we were losing early on.
Can I just add something? Did you share with Nick Taylor that week?
Yeah, I did.
He never stopped talking.
kept you awake. I was speaking to Nick earlier today, and he said that he was speaking to you, obviously he was sharing with you when you won that British Open. And he said every day, each opponent you had, you said to him, I don't think I'm going to win today.
Just try and play it down.
He really did play it down, so maybe that's the secret. Just go in and with that attitude, and we win a British Open. A lucky British Open, that way. So.
Share with Nick
Taylor, that's the way forward.
Shared with him many other times, I never lost one again either. That was just a good week.
Well, it's cool to hear the stories. Amazing careers, fantastic squash players, brilliant to watch you guys play. Amazing stuff again. Please give them a huge round of applause. And sign the So please be back for the 4th match of the evening. Thank you. Ready to welcome our players on court. You guys are ready? He is from Holland. He is the first ever Dutch player to make it to the top 10 in the world, reaching a world ranking of number 9 at his highest, winner of 12 world titles on the PSA World Tour. He is the current World Over 35 champion. Please welcome LJ Anjema. LJ's opponent this evening, he has 36 PSA World Tour titles from 58 finals over the years. He's a World Open winner, a British Open winner, and a Commonwealth Games gold medalist. Please welcome the former world number one, Jonathan Power.
Match number 4. LJ Anjema to serve. down to Parrott to receive. Best of three games. Love all.
Thank you. Yes, like it.
And now,
JP.
LJ's in and he's receiving a little bit of flack for this, as you might have heard. So it's not an easy situation, but to be in an event like this with the players that you're playing against, how does it feel?
It feels very special. I remember when I was a kid, growing up in Holland, the Dutch Open was in Maastricht, and my dad said, okay, let's go there and watch them play. And I saw this Canadian guy played Jan Sherkan in the first round, and they were brought onto the court with Harley Davidsons. They sat on the back of his motorbike, and I thought it was the coolest thing ever. And after the match, I went up to the new Canadian super talent, and I asked him, can I get your bandana? Would you give it to me? And it was like the coolest thing ever, that the Canadian flag on it with the McDonald's sign.
I thought you were going to say you're still wearing it.
Well, I actually brought it with me, so... No, just kidding. I really wanted to bring it with me, but it got lost when I moved house. So.
I thought you said it wasn't
free. No, it's a great honor to play these guys, and if I'm on court with Jonathan, I still feel like a kid, you know, like I can't help it, you know. It's you would think, okay, I'm growing up now, I'm retired, but I still feel like a kid when I'm on court with him. So.
It's a cool story. Like, so heading out in Maastricht for a major event on the back of a Harley Davidson to play Jancha. Do you remember a little kid coming up to you afterwards and stealing your headband?
Yeah, for sure. I remember it vividly.
He's beating Jancha, that is. But that was a special tournament for me because I based myself in Holland, so winning the Dutch Open was second to winning the Canadian Open for me. It was a big one, and like I got to come out in Harley Davidson's, but while they were clutched onto the back, I was standing. So I was celebrating the Amsterdam or the Dutch culture, sort of standing on the back of the bike. No, those were good times for sure.
I feel in a silly mood now that we could replicate that somehow coming down here. We have loads of bikes, right? I mean,
we got rentals.
I have loads of sensible legends around. I can just imagine one of the boys volunteering to ride you down here. Maybe Johnny White in charge of the bike, and you standing on the back would be a great entrance to the court, wouldn't it?
How will he do it if he has 10 beers first?
I believe he's ready right now. I haven't seen him for a while. I think he's either. It's either with the physio, the physio and the doctor, or the bar. Back to the squash. I want to ask you, Jonathan, about your career, because it's epic. You've obviously gone all the way, you've won pretty much everything. Is there a moment or something that stands out to you, like a pinnacle, or a moment that really is the one?
Oh yeah, 100%. Winning the World Open for the first time and becoming number one in the world, that was sort of all in one event. When you're a kid, you just want to become number one in the world, and you practice by yourself a million times, thinking about it in your head, and then when it comes, it's like all the pressure is off you, and then all the pressure, and then a different pressure comes on you. Now you got to defend, but getting there was the moment of relief, because in my mind, I thought I was going to get there since I was little, and then you finally actually do what you were telling everybody you're going to do, which never really happens. It was a big relief, for sure. That was the moment.
And then so, it's squash careers, there's a million squash players out there like us who are just playing and hanging and enjoying our squash, and then there's these many, 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 many pros who get nowhere near it, and then there's guys who make top 10 in the world, which is an amazing feat in itself. For you in your career, which has just changed recently going into coaching, but like for you, what's your standout moment or something across the years that was a big moment for you during your squash?
It was basically, I was maybe ranked 14, 15 in the world, and I was doing well and really tried to make top 10. And then in the summer, I went to Colorado. And for 3-4 weeks, I trained in the mountains there, in the Rocky Mountains. And I was just so fit, you know, and I really enjoyed my training as well, doing trail running, mountain biking, rock climbing. And after those 3-4 weeks, I was as fit as Superman, and I went back to Holland and I trained at sea level really hard as well. And it was just a beautiful summer, and I was in such a strong state of mind when I started the season, and I started making my first quarterfinals of like the World Series events, the biggest events, and
just a great moment, the moment that I knew I jumped from 11 to 9. And I really feel that I got the most out of my career, you know. At that stage, Shorebeggy was ranked 8th in the world. He had like 150 points on average more than I did. And I pushed as hard as I could, and I just couldn't get higher. And I feel really good about it, you know. Like I feel at peace with my career, you know. So, yeah. Cool.
Saying with this event, it's called Legends for a reason. It's because they all are. They're fantastic, not just at the way that they hit the ball and they move around the court, but the way they promote the sport around the world, the way that they've held themselves over many years, and then every time they come back to Bermuda, it's just awesome. So thank you very much for coming back every year. It's been a pleasure for us all to watch them play. We'll get a couple more days out of it this week, so thank you very much. Huge round of applause for John. Two core rats left, my little volunteers, all the people around the club who helped me out. Massive thank you to you guys, Elijah up there, Spencer in the middle, Micah, Anaya, Dave outside, all of my gang. If you want to have a beer with us, please come upstairs, we'll see you in the bar.